Dennis, we saw Canadian REITs take a considerable downturn, of course, being impacted by the pandemic. Do you see a long-term structural change here?
Unfortunately, a blanket answer doesn't apply to all real estate, not even in Canada. Various subsectors are impacted differently. So at one end of the spectrum, you have companies that are in the industrial space, where they have actually seen an acceleration in activity, in demand, in occupancy, in rent growth, driven by the pandemic. And that's because people have shifted their purchasing. E-commerce was an emerging trend before the pandemic. And of course, shelter-in-place orders have forced more and more people to adopt e-commerce at a faster clip. In fact, in April of last year, 40 million Americans purchased something online for the first time. So you can see the rapid acceleration. On the other end of the spectrum, you know, retail was suffering from that in that impact and that structural trend before the pandemic. And of course, with shelter in place and forced shutdowns, retail real estate has really suffered from the pandemic. So it really does require a very, very active and systematic approach to investing in real estate, given the pandemic's disproportionate impact on various subsectors.
You mentioned the various subsectors, and of course, we know that REITs are really this mixed bag of residential, industrial, commercial, infrastructure. So where do you look for growth at this point?
No matter what cycle or what stage of the market that you're in, you're always looking for real estate landlords who have attractive real estate located in geographies where job growth is ahead of the national average, where household formation is above the national average, because that leads to increased demand for commercial real estate. Everyone talks location, 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 Larysa, but it's really about jobs, jobs, jobs. Wherever jobs are created, people migrate to, and that creates a demand for more real estate to support them. So again, if we're looking at Canada, you're looking for, and if you're looking to allocate to real estate in general, you're always looking for those sectors or those geographies that have got increased demand. That leads to rent growth, it leads to occupancy growth and cash flow growth. So if I look at what's happened since the pandemic, industrial real estate has done very, very well. You mentioned infrastructure, specifically data center and cell tower REITs. They've done exceptionally well. And on the other end of the spectrum, retail has done very, very poorly. Office has sort of been neutral to slightly negative. And the seniors housing space in Canada has been disproportionately negatively impacted because this is a healthcare concern. And so as we've seen outbreaks in various nursing homes and the National Guard called in, it's really been a struggle and a challenge for the seniors home operators in this environment.
Do you think that REIT indexes need greater exposure? Listening to you speak, I mean, you know, we know now that data centers are much more important, that these call centers, that these warehouses, mobile towers, does it need to, you know, kind of need to see a shift within the index itself?
Well, the challenge is that those businesses and those real estate entities exist within Canada. But for instance, if you're looking for data center exposure in Canada, a lot of it is owned by Equinix, which is, of course, a U.S. REIT that is actually not even in the U.S. real estate in this the broad real estate index in the United States. If you're looking for exposure to various subsectors within Canada, some of them are in diversified names. So for instance, H&R is a large diversified REIT in Canada. It includes office, retail, and a little bit of industrial as well. So it's a bit of a challenge in Canada, and it has nothing to do with the quality of real estate and has everything to do with the fact that we tend to live in the same six cities: Vancouver, Edmonton, Toronto, Calgary, Ottawa, Montreal. And so the real estate that's truly valuable from an institutional standpoint and a publicly listed standpoint is concentrated in those six markets. And to the extent that any private company or U.S. company aggregates a lot of it, it makes it a challenge to have that reflected in publicly traded indices.
Indulge us here for a moment. We've asked this question of our guests so many times. I guess the billion-dollar question is, as people adopt this work-from-home model, what happens now? I'm sure you've heard this before.
Yeah, and what I would say is it is really company-dependent, and that sounds like a bit of a cop-out, but I'll explain. We actually had an event with a very, very large financial services company, and they told us that they've actually been back to the office since May of last year, and they've got the wherewithal and the resources to pay to have their employees tested every day. So they have not bowed to the whole work from home trend that a lot of people have espoused. On the other end of the spectrum, you have a lot of tech-oriented businesses like Google that have allowed their employees to stay home until sometime later this year. What I think you're going to find is it's industry and company dependent. Companies with greater resources will reward their employees with greater flexibility. Work from home, work in the office, or some sort of hybrid model. Companies where culture is increasingly dependent on people being in close proximity, or a need for efficiency that's driven by close proximity, those companies will, of course, have their employees come back. And companies where it's a personal experience, where the actual interaction face-to-face is the business, they will, of course, have to come back. So we look at it and we say, for office in particular, where I think you're headed with this question, the impact is going to be neutral to slightly negative. And, you know, I was just joking with my girlfriend yesterday that 5 years from now, we'll look back on this and say, do you remember when we spent a year at home working from home? I think a lot of people employed in professional capacities will look back on this time period 5 years from now and talk about how they spent that year at home, but most of them will return to the office.
Do you see a disconnect between Canadian residential and Canadian commercial?
Definitely. And I sound like it's fitting that it's Groundhog Day, and I keep repeating myself, but it is sector specific. So when we look at residential, it is closer in operations to industrial in that occupancy has been retained, rent collection is very high, cash flow growth is there, resulting in distribution increase, and the value of the real estate has continued to appreciate each quarter. However, the sector as a whole in Canada trades at a discount to its net asset value, which doesn't happen very often. Now, if you're going to compare residential to other sectors of commercial like office, it's, again, performed better from an operational standpoint, but is closer in terms of the performance in the market to, say, office or retail. So it's a bit of a conundrum. We look at it from a fundamental standpoint and say there's a terrific opportunity in residential real estate. We know this for a fact. We had a second event with CBRE, a very large international global property asset management and brokerage firm, and they just really confirmed our thoughts around residential real estate. So, Larysa, there's definitely a disconnect, and for the time being, investors can take advantage of it by collecting very, very tax-efficient income and waiting for the market to prove them right.
What should investors stay away from?
Investors should stay away from anything that's struggling to grow, struggling to generate cash flow growth. And the great thing about the stock market is companies report to you at least four times a year telling you exactly how they're performing. And there's an old saying, when somebody tells you who they are, believe them. Well, when companies tell you four times a year how they're doing, you should believe them. And that goes in both ways. If companies tell you consistently every quarter that they're performing very well, and they back it up by giving you increasing dividends, then you should believe them. And conversely, when companies tell you that they're struggling and they're laboring, you should believe them and not expect them to do something different, whether it's in the market or when they report to you. So, you know, you should always avoid companies that are struggling, that are seeing the value of their real estate decline, that are struggling to pay their distribution, or in sectors that you can see are in cyclical decline or structural decline, I should say. That's what should always be avoided, whether it's during a pandemic or during boom times.